Hey everyone, Cleo here, and today I'm giving you a book talk for The Name of All Things by Jen Lyons. I really have to film this video for once because I've almost finished the third book in this series. So before we dive into The Name of All Things, I need to clarify that The Name of All Things is the second book in A Course of Dragons. As this is the second book in a series, I won't really dive into the series as a whole or anything like that, and it might contain mild spoilers for book one. So if you haven't read the series yet and you don't have any idea about what I'm talking about, it might be better for you to check out my other book talk on The Rune of Kings, first book within this series. Now, for those of you sticking around within this video, the first thing that I should be mentioning is if you are worried because you have read The Rune of Kings a while back and you don't really know whether you remember all that well, or if you've just read The Rune of Kings and you're not sure that you understood what took place within it, The Name of All Things actually starts with a summary of The Rune of Kings, and the summary was a nice surprise because it made me feel like I did actually understand The Rune of Kings a lot better than I thought that I had. And so, as in The Rune of Kings, The Name of All Things reprises that sort of complex structure. So once again, the book is being presented as a report being drawn up based on the events that have just taken place. The report will once again have a frame story and a story within the story. The frame story in this case is continuing on from the timeline of the first book, so it is continuing right after the events that have unfolded in Rune of Kings. However, the story within the story will take place in the timeline of the first book and will be following events in a different part of the Empire, following different characters. This story is very much centered around the characters of Janelle and Cohn. Just like in The Rune of Kings, the story within the story is told through two different perspectives. Unlike in The Rune of Kings, it is not told through different timelines. From time to time, the timeline between the two will diverge, as these characters might not always be together for the vast majority of their storyline. They are basically just taking turns telling the story of what had happened with them in their story. However, from time to time, towards the ending of the story within the story, their perspectives are changing as they have different events taking place within the storyline. Within the frame story, they are telling their story to Kieran as they are stuck in a tavern due to circumstances. That's a nice way for us to keep Kieran in the focus of the story as well, and to get some more nice interactions between Janelle and Kieran. And then, as was the case with The Rune of Kings, at some point within the story, the story within the story catches up to the timeline of the frame story, and the story continues from there on out. Now, based on your experiences with The Rune of Kings, you can understand that I'm mainly going to be talking about the story within the story. The frame story only really becomes important when we get to that second half of the novel, or that like final quarter of the novel, where the story within the story has caught up to the frame story. And because there is so much going down in the story within the story that I would be spoiling if I go into that final quarter of the book, I'm only going to talk about the story within the story here. So in the story within the story, we are looking at Janelle and Cohn in the Joret Empire. Now, through this book, we will be learning a lot more about Jorati society, and it is a super interesting society that we're diving into, as well as we're looking at it from the perspective of people who have grown up in this society and fully understand the implications of the cultural differences and the way in which this society looks at sex and gender in particular, and then outsider characters who either are pretending to be insiders or who are perplexed by the way in which Jorati society works. So as I already indicated in that sentence, one of the main elements of Jorati society that we're diving into is their sort of different take on sex and gender. In Jorati society, sex doesn't automatically equal gender. This is of course something that we see more and more these days in our modern society. I think when I grew up, of course, everybody just assumed that female meant you were a woman and that male meant that you were a man, and there wasn't really anybody combating that idea or contesting that idea, whereas now we see a lot more of gender fluidity, for example, and a lot more of people who are born a certain way but identify another way. And so in this society, rather than that being a sort of like evolution that is taking place, that is a given. Whether you are born female or male has no impact on whether you identify as a woman or a man. And the word woman or man actually isn't even appropriate in this context because they have different terminology that they use and terminology that covers a different base than a woman or man would, for example. So the Djorti society is very much a horse-centric society. They have a very close link to horses, but especially to Firebloods. And Firebloods, we have been introduced to these within the first book. So we do have a Firebloods that is linked to House Domon at that point in time. And we will be re-evaluating Firebloods within this book because within Djorti society there is a very different relationship to Firebloods than there was within the Kurus Empire, for example, within Kurus society. And in line with this horse-centered structure, the terminology that they use for their different genders is also horse-related. And so we will not be speaking of men and women. We are speaking of stallions, mares, and geldings. And so your stallions would be like your warriors, your rulers. The mares, on the other hand, are a little bit more than sedentary, subservient, now I cannot think of the word that you are the supportive figure. And then into the geldings, we don't really dive that much into the geldings within this book, but it's definitely mentioned, and that's kind of if you identify between the two, if you don't fully identify as stallion or fully identify as mare. And so this society is very interesting to follow because it's a society in which it is totally acceptable for somebody to be born female and to identify as a stallion, for example. And then we get a sort of interesting mix of a society in which this is acceptable, in which this is normal, with then some outside figures coming in and being baffled or constantly making sort of like mistakes against this sort of system. And so it's very interesting diving into this society that splits these two, that really has a sort of split between what you are born as and what you identify as. There is also even the possibility for physical transformation from female to male, for example. That is also a possibility that exists within this society. And so it's an interesting society, and it's interesting to look at it as a normalized way of living, a normalized way, aspect of culture, because as we are seeing it modern day, it's very much something that is still contested. A lot of people are hesitant to embrace these type of differences between the way that somebody is born and the way that somebody identifies. There's definitely a lot of resistance towards that in our modern day society. And so it's interesting to present a society in which that is normalized, while at the same time also showing that sort of conflict we have in our modern day, present day times by introducing some outside figures. You know, when Kieran is introduced to this story, Kieran, who is coming from Kur Empire, who has been brought up with a traditional view on sex and gender. So his sort of reaction and confusion when it comes to this terminology is very interesting to look at. This sort of confusion coming from outsiders into this culture is used as well in a sort of plot sense within this book, because within the plot there are often people who are showing that they don't have the correct knowledge on this culture, the correct knowledge on the way in which the gender identity works within this knowledge, and that's a way in which people such as Janelle can then identify the fact that that is an outsider and that that is an imposter, for example. So I really love that aspect of the novel and the way in which it incorporated that culture so heavily with the plots, and how much we really got a deep dive into that culture and the way of life through the perspective of Janelle. When it comes to the culture of this world, I definitely also want to speak a little bit more on the Firebloods still, because as I said in the beginning, the Firebloods will be given a sort of new interpretation within this book, because within the original book and within Rune of Kings we were kind of introduced to Firebloods as being this sort of like elite type of horse, this sort of exceptional breed of horses, kind of, let's think of it as like the Mustangs within our world, you know, these sort of like high breed horses that people really want because they have superior qualities to your average horse. And this has kind of been the way in which we've seen Firebloods so far. However, when we then get to Djorti society, these Firebloods, comparing Firebloods to horses is kind of insulting Firebloods, you know, because Firebloods are kind of seen as a people. Firebloods have a language which Djorti's people actually learn from childhood onwards, whereas the Kur people don't even realize that they could communicate with the Firebloods. They just think, okay, they're just animals. There's no way that they could understand what we're saying. We need to try and get them to do what we want them to do, the way that we would get a horse to do what we want to. Whereas the Jortis have developed a relationship to the Firebloods. They speak their language, they are able to communicate, they are able to gather loyalty through that type of deep bond, and they have a lot of respect for Firebloods. And it's not the case that a Fireblood is the property of somebody or something like that. You more or less have just like the loyalty of a Fireblood if you're lucky. And so Firebloods are very much a society of their own, a people of their own. And so I'm hoping that we're diving into that a little bit more as well as the books progress. But so it's so interesting that we have this element that we have been introduced to in a certain light in the first book, and how we've accepted that way of looking at the Firebloods, and then we now are introduced to a totally new way of looking at Firebloods, to a totally new understanding of what these Firebloods are. And so that kind of also opens up the entire empire. But there are probably a whole lot of other elements to this world that we've seen through a certain lens, that we've seen through Kieran's perspective, but also through his prejudices, to the way in which he has been told that the world works. And so it'll be interesting to dive into other cultures within this world and other aspects of this world and reevaluate things that we have taken for granted so far. Now, there's not much that I'm going to dive into in terms of plot. I will say that with the first one of the main complaints is its complexity. If you're watching this video, I'm going to assume that you like that complexity and that you want to continue in spite of sometimes feeling confused with this world. I will say the second book is the most comprehensible of the three so far. So in the second one, I only once was like, ugh, you lost me there. But that's also because it kind of harkened back to something that had been introduced in the first book and that I still didn't fully follow. But because the second book kind of starts from point zero again, for the vast majority of it, you don't need any sort of prior knowledge to dive into it. And because we don't really have a lot of soul swapping or reincarnation or things like that taking place within this book anymore, it becomes a lot more comprehensible. And so I would say that if you are kind of doubting after reading the first one because you felt like you couldn't really follow and you're not sure you want to continue because it's just going to get more and more complex, the second book in that sense is definitely a lot more comprehensible. You won't feel as lost. I feel like book one and two kind of work in parallel to one another. And so possible elements that you might not have fully understood in the first one won't really impact the second one, just slightly. Towards the end there are some elements from the world building of the first one that reappear. But I would still say that even though at this point in the third book, for example, there are still some elements that I'm like, I really should have paid more attention to that in the first book because I still don't fully understand, I am still also fully enjoying this book. So if you read through the first one, were confused but still liked it, you will definitely still continue on liking the second and the third one. I think all of the elements that you loved about book one will be there in the sequel. I will say that so far, The Name of All Things is my least favorite within the series, and I don't fully know why. I think the storyline of this one just was less interesting to me, I guess. For a long time, it felt like it was just kind of sort of like separate adventure, but it does tie in with the overarching plots towards the end. And just like it happened with the first book, there are definitely a lot of like side plots, it seems, or like the plot kind of meanders from time to time. It feels a lot more like there isn't a plan and they're just reacting to what is happening. But definitely already in the third one as well, we have kind of referred back to things that have happened within the second one that you kind of felt like, why was it even there when you got to the end of the second book? And that now in the third book you're like, okay, we are definitely still building off of what has taken place there. So I would say there are sometimes elements introduced that seem like they might not be important, and maybe some of those will end up not being important at all when the entire series is completed. But there are definitely also some of those cases that we are building off of because some of those characters will become more important and things like that. So I definitely still enjoyed The Name of All Things. As I said, it was my least favorite within this series so far, but I still have enjoyed it, still flew through this one. And it was also a little bit of a nice change from the first ones in terms of it being so comprehensible, though perhaps that is part of the reason why I enjoyed the first one more, because I felt a little bit more of that mystery element to the first one compared to the second one. But so yeah, that's going to be everything that I'm diving into with The Name of All Things. As with The Name of All Things, I'll also do a video like this for The Memory of Souls. I have like 4 hours left in the audiobook at this point in time, so that probably coming your way relatively soon, depending on how quickly I film my book talk after finishing it. But so yeah, let me know down below if you have read The Name of All Things, what your thoughts were on it, if you've read The Rune of Kings, and you're hesitating diving into the second one, ask me any question you want down below, and we can definitely talk about it. And so hope you guys enjoyed this video, and see you guys for a future one.